Hi there! Welcome to this episode of Lights Out, your virtual campfire. I'm your hostess with the mostest ghosties, Sylvia Shults. I do a lot of traveling as I go around seeking the paranormal. One of my favorite things to do is to find ghost tours in the towns I visit. It's even better when I can learn something about the history of the place, too. Come along with me as we explore the history and hauntings in Naperville. Let's go. Lights out. Kevin Frantz is a distinguished-looking man with a leonine head of snow-white hair. He's a historian, a paranormal investigator, and a professional storyteller. The Naperville Ghost Tour, billed as the official ghost tour of Naperville, is led by this genial ghost hunter. Now, I have to confess something right from the jump for this episode of Lights Out. I had such a delightful time listening to Kevin spin his tales of history and ghosts that I forgot to turn on my recorder for a lot of the tour. But don't worry, I've still got some super fun stories for you, I promise. Kevin and I met at Central Park in Naperville for my tour. And I can unreservedly say it was my tour, since I was the only one there. So yes, I got a personalized glimpse into Naperville's haunted history. Kevin began our evening by telling me about a spooky, smoke-like apparition that has been seen in the park and all over town for over a century.
In front of you with no warning at all. And as it moves away from you, though, it turns almost into what looks like a wispy cape as it fades away. And people have been seeing it in here for like 150 years. And a lot of people still see it. The thing is also seen around Naperville, but it's most commonly seen right here in the park.
Huh.
And so we've often wondered, like, what is it about the park that this thing, you know, has an attachment to, if you will?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it turns out That right there is a concert hall. That mural opens up. That's like a huge band shell. They do concerts here.
Oh, wow.
That's what that is. Well, on the far right side of it right there, there used to be a building,
uh-huh.
A courthouse building. Let me see if I got a picture of it. The courthouse was right over there. That's right there. Okay, good.
Ooh.
That's what it looked like.
Uh-huh.
That's it.
Okay.
And it used to stand right there. In fact, that street right there is called Court Street because that was the street you took to get to the courthouse right
okay.
there. And that street there used to go all the way through and connect over here back in the old days.
Mm.
It was divided. Anyway, court was the, that had the jail on the ground floor.
Okay.
And the courtroom was upstairs. So if someone was in jail, they could look out on the park. And it turns out that may be connected to our phantom.
Oh.
Here's why. Listen to this. In 2007, my team was called for an investigation into an old building that's on Jefferson Street. Today it's the Naperville Running Company, but it was originally built in 1910, something like that. And it was originally a vaudeville theater and stuff like that. And over the years it was a movie theater, all kinds of stuff. Very haunted building. Well, they call us in to investigate because there's some crazy shit going on there.
Mm-hmm.
So I've got about five or six people with me. I'm the lead investigator, and a psychic and I go down into the basement of this place. Everybody else is on the ground floor. It's about 2 o'clock in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
It's pitch dark down there. I shouldn't say pitch dark, but very dark down there. She's off in her corner doing her thing. I'm over here doing whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And suddenly the silence down there is shattered by the sound of my psychic screaming like this. You can't hurt me. You can't hurt me. You can't hurt me. You can't hurt me like this. She scared the shit out of me.
Hmm.
I go running up to her and I said, what do you see? Tell me what you see. And she like just backed away from the wall and she said, keep away. I can't protect you from it. And I said, tell me what you see. And she said, she goes, it's like black smoke. Now she didn't know anything about phantom. And I said, you see black smoke right now, right there? And she just like looked at me like, yeah. And I said, ask its name. And she goes, what? I go, hurry. She goes, who are you? Who are you? Who are you? She got out three or four times. And then she turns around and starts to like dry heave. Like, And I said, would you quit throwing up and tell me what is going on? And she just looked at me with this anger on her face that a lot of women tend to have with me. And she had this anger on her face. And she said, he's trying to scare me. He just morphed into a hanging man. And with that, he was gone.
Oh.
Now, when I wrote the report for that investigation, I put in the report, it seems to me that the phantom that's been haunting Naperville for 150 years was in your basement. He tried to scare my psychic by morphing into a hanging man. That's what I put in the report.
Uh-huh.
But I was wrong. Huh. I was wrong.
Well, that seems like a pretty good line of inquiry there.
But listen, as I thought about this, I came to realize that he wasn't trying to scare her. He was answering her question, who are you?
Okay.
Because as I did the research on it, I found out that Naperville only has one hanging man. Naperville used to be the county seat for DuPage.
Okay.
Today, Wheaton is. Okay. And there's a whole story with that. That's another ish. That's for another day.
Okay.
But back then, Naperville was the county seat for DuPage, and that was the courthouse building. And as the county seat for DuPage at that time, Naperville only has one legal execution by hanging in its history book.
Oh, lovely.
So, okay. So get this. His name is Patrick Doyle. Okay. Patrick Doyle was arrested for the murder of Patrick Toll.
Okay.
Now, the murder actually happened over in Warrenville, a few miles away. And what happened is, in the fall of 1853, the Toll brothers were paid by the railroad $60 for their work. And Doyle didn't get paid that day, but he saw them get paid. Now, this is all, by the way, from the newspaper. I'm not filling anything in. This is from the newspaper. Okay. Mm-hmm. So, they get their money. He doesn't get his. And so they jump on this wagon that's going to take him to another town or whatever. And Doyle jumps up on the wagon with him, all the while watching for his chance to part them from their cash.
Mm-hmm.
The boys start drinking on the two brothers start drinking on the thing. And the one gets exceedingly drunk. In fact, so drunk, he falls off of the wagon at one point.
Mm.
Okay. They stop the wagon. His brother jumps down to help him. And when he does that, he turns his back on Doyle. And that's when it happened.
Mm.
The witnesses say that Doyle grabbed a nearby fence post and started to beat the sober Toll brother over the head with the pole so hard that his brain spilled out into the mud.
Why would he do this in front of witnesses?
Because he's crazy.
What an idiot.
So he does this, okay? And then he goes through their pockets. The drunk one's not a problem. He just goes through his pockets. But the other one's dead. He grabs his money and takes off. And interestingly, they find the money not far from the scene. So they don't know if he dropped it or what, but they found the money. But anyway.
Hmm.
So the guy on the wagon heads back to Naperville, tells him what happened, gives a description to the sheriff from the courthouse right there. They find Doyle on Randolph Street in Chicago a couple days later.
Mm-hmm.
He's arrested, and he sits in that jail that was right there. He's right there for 6 months waiting for his trial. Now, in the spring of 1854, there's a session of the court, or whatever, however they did that, and there's a trial. He's guilty, and he's going to hang for that. And they hanged him out near Ritzer's gravel pit, which is down on Chicago Avenue. There's a whole thing in the newspaper about how it was a big spectacle. Everybody came out. It was, okay.
Mm-hmm.
But here's the freaky thing. Okay, now you might think to yourself, a lot of people get hanged. They don't become smoky black things.
Right.
And that would be true. But here's the thing. When somebody's dangling at the end of their rope, that's the end of their story, right? Okay. When Doyle was hanging at the end of his rope, his story was just starting up. Get this. They cut him down. They put him in a coffin. And they run him over to St. Peter and Paul Cemetery. That's St. Peter and Paul Church right there.
Okay.
They run him over to St. Peter and Paul Cemetery because he's Irish Catholic. The powers that be at the cemetery said, "We can't bury him here. He's a murderer. Can't put him on our sacred ground." So they said, no problem, we'll bring him to the Naperville Cemetery. It's a new cemetery. It's right up the street, by the way, in case you didn't see it. It's right up the street there.
Mm-hmm.
So they run him over there. powers that be at that cemetery said, it's great to see you guys, but we have a small problem. We don't have a potter's field yet, or a new cemetery. We don't have anywhere to put it. So now, the city fathers in Naperville have this coffin with their first execution. Turned out to be their only one, but they thought their first one. And they have nowhere to go with them. Now, there's a restaurant right up the street called Jimmy's Grill, okay? And it sits on a piece of land that back then had a huge business on it called Beckman's Harness Shop. Now, Philip Beckman was one of the city fathers. And okay. He's there and he says, here's what you do, guys. Put Doyle in the attic of the harness shop. When we figure out what to do with him, we'll just deal with it then. So that's what they did. So they put him in the attic of the harness shop. Okay. Beckman retires 40 years later. They find Doyle in the attic. No one ever did anything with him.
Oh, no.
Now, there's a doctor in town named Hamilton Daniels. Hamilton uh-huh. Daniels had his office right across the street, right about where that athletic thing is right there.
Okay.
He goes down. He claims the coffin. Drags back to his office. Opens it, and it's just bones. He keeps it for a little while, but then he donates it to the college. Now, the college had a record of it being donated to them. Patrick Doyle was donated to the college by Dr. Daniels.
Yeah.
Some students over the years claim they saw the skeleton in there, his hand in some of the classrooms and stuff. So it was there. Problem is this. The college no longer has it. And there's no record of its disposal from the college. There's no record of where it went. Mm. And there's no one buried in any of the Naperville cemeteries named Patrick Doyle from 1854. So where are the bones of Naperville's one and only execution? Where'd they go? Now, is being hanged for murder, rotting in an attic, being on display at the college, and never having your bones buried, is that enough to turn you into a pissed off black phantom thing? You better believe it is.
It's more than enough. I think so, yes.
Okay, so we think that Doyle is our phantom. Now, we're investigators, so what do? Chuck and I stood right here.
Yeah.
Okay, with an EVP. And we said, Patrick Doyle, are you here? Yes. A couple more questions he doesn't answer. Uh-huh. Then we asked him about 40 questions and he answered like 6 of them. Okay. The ones he answered are basically this. Let's see. Are you here? Yes. Would you talk to us? Why? And well, because we think you were hanging, and nothing. And then we said, do you haunt Naperville because you were never buried? And he said, yes. Mm-hmm. And nothing. And then we said, why do you haunt the park? And he said, I can't rest. Those were the gist of what he said. And on the tour, we play those EVPs. Not this year, I don't. But we have in the past, where people can actually hear Patrick Doyle responding on the tape to us. We were standing right there. So we think we've got a lot of evidence that Patrick Doyle, Naperville's one and only hanged man, when we saw the phantom and said, who are you? He morphed into a hanging man. And my psychic said that when he morphed into the hanging man, he was so grotesque, that's what caused her to start throwing up.
Mm.
So it all ties together, all the pieces. By the way, this is all in the book, plus a whole bunch more. So if you get a chance to see the book, you want at least the third edition. I think the third edition is the one that has the phantom in it.
Okay.
The new edition, the fourth one, I'm actually taking the phantom out. Because I'm going to put him back on the tour, and I don't want it in the book. I try to keep the book, I try to make it where the book has different stories in it that I'm telling. And the book usually has about 30 stories in it.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't want them to be the same ones. I don't want people to buy the book and then go home and just read the same ones they just heard. Maybe they wouldn't care, but I feel like, that's not a cool thing.
One of the most fascinating stories Kevin shared with me was the notorious tale of the grave robber next door. In 1912, Charles Hillegas lost his beautiful young wife. Being an educated man of the 20th century, Charles did what he thought would be best for his beloved late wife. He dug her up, brought her back home, and, some say, tried to bring her back to life. Kevin has written an excellent, thoroughly researched book on this macabre case of a love gone just a little too far. Called, of course, The Grave Robber Next Door, it's available on Amazon. Another great story Kevin told me is that of a phantom horse that can be heard clip-clopping down the streets near St. Peter and Paul Catholic Church. The horse is an integral part of a Naperville legend, the tale of the Weeping Bride. A young woman, daughter of a wealthy family, had the bad luck to fall in love with a man who turned out to be a gold-digging scoundrel. She accepted his proposal of marriage, booked the church, and planned the entire wedding, completely unaware that this jerk was simply planning to run off with her family's money and leave her at the altar. On a cold autumn day, that's exactly what happened. The bride showed up at the church in all her wedding finery, riding a beautiful horse for the happy occasion. The guests were all waiting in the church, and the bride joined them, and there they all waited, and waited, and waited. The bride's father understood what had happened, and, wanting to spare his daughter further embarrassment, offered to take her home. She insisted that her errant fiancé would show up sooner or later, but she was finally forced to admit the terrible truth. He'd left her at the altar. She rode the horse home. Dejected, her spirits shattered, soaked to the skin in the awful weather, she caught a chill and died. But her horse continues to pace the streets of Naperville. Kevin caught the clop of the horse's hoofs on video, and you can see the astonishing clip on YouTube. Just type in Ghost Horse Naperville and prepare to be amazed. As I said, I was so entranced by Kevin's storytelling that I ended up not recording quite a lot of the tour. That just means you'll have to go on one of his tours your own self, you know. To make up for that, Kevin was kind enough to share some personal experiences with me as we sat down to a late pizza dinner.
Come on. Okay. So let's talk about ghosts and books. How did you get started in ghost hunting? How did you get involved in it?
Oh, my God. That's a big question. As a kid, my favorite shows were like Night Gallery and stuff like that. I loved those kinds of things. Uh-huh. I started writing stories like that as a kid.
Uh-huh.
I used to write my own stories. And then as I got older, I got into spiritual stuff, Christianity and stuff. I got a degree in biblical study. I'm a minister, mm-hmm. actually. And started getting into that. And then I wrote a book called The Journals of Father Nick Thomas. And it was this priest who would go back in time and stuff. And it won an internet award and stuff.
Cool.
And one thing led to another. And I started writing stuff. And then I started researching the ghost stuff, uh-huh. you know. And I was in the video business. And I saw this story online where it said, do you have what it takes to be a ghost hunter?
Okay.
And I thought it was curious, so I clicked on it, and it basically said you needed needed patience, but you need a certain kind of equipment, and I had it from my video business.
Ah.
And I had training in it. I owned a video production company. Uh-huh. And so my wife and I went ghost hunting in the Naperville Cemetery,
mm-hmm.
and we were hooked. We got some cool stuff, and so that was the end of that, you know. And then I put together a ghost hunting program called Casper.
Okay.
Because I know, as I talked to ghost hunters, I realized they were using the equipment all wrong.
Oh, okay.
And so I put together this program called Casper. Casper was an acronym, CASPER. It meant committed to acquiring superior paranormal evidence and results.
Sweet.
It was basically to teach you how to be a real good ghost hunter.
Okay.
And that was real popular. I mean, we were teaching that class all over the place. You know, people were learning how to how to get evidence that would stand up to scrutiny, like, you know, and how to behave on an investigation so that it's professional. Like a guideline in Casper would be like, if you're on first of all, the difference between a ghost hunt and an investigation, that was key, you know. But on an investigation, you never whisper, okay? Mm-hmm. That's like a big deal. Like, you know, you never say, you know, if you're out there, you know, ghost hunting, you never say, hey, do you want to go to Taco Bell when we get out of here? Because the guy who's listening to the tapes later goes, I hear something. Okay. And I think it's
never something. Never ever whisper on an investigation.
Yeah, I think it's something about going to hell. You know. You know what I mean?
Yes, yeah. I know exactly what you mean.
it was stuff like that. And how to follow protocols so that your evidence stays credible and stands to scrutiny and stuff like that. And because of that, I ended up being the president of a club called Heartland Paranormal here in the suburbs. And it had about 70 members. It grew real fast.
Wow.
And we were teaching people how to be ghost hunters.
Uh-huh.
I was the president of the club. And, so that's kind of how the whole thing is.
So, what drew you to the history as well as the ghosts?
Well, that started with the Naper Historical Society. I've always been like meticulous as far as like researching and stuff like that. That's just in my nature to do that. That's why I was working with them. But as these stories started to keep coming up with ghosts, I just thought, well, it's about finding out the facts like that support the haunt. Like, anyone could tell there's a ghost in this house, but who is the ghost? Like, let's look at like Hallie, okay, in the library. They've been talking about this ghost in the Nichols Library for 50 years, but no one knew who he was. So we got to the bottom of who he was, and now we know who he is and why he's there.
I think that always gives such a more personal approach to the stories. I mean, if you know who it is, you can make that connection and know that this person really lived. And
it makes it more real.
It does. It does.
Yeah. I think that, you know, kind of like The Exorcist, you know, when people saw it, they were fainting and throwing up and all this kind of stuff, but that's because they knew it was based on a true story. That makes it more real.
See? Oh, yeah. Much more visceral.
Yeah. So that's why I mean, I could talk about Charles and Jesse, but if I can, you know, show you a picture of them right up front and then show you, you know, the story from the newspaper that it actually happened, here it is, you know, and show you the tombstones, how we found them. I mean, all of that stuff is very, you know, solid, you know, for driving home the fact that this is real. You know, you're
standing on the spot. Were real
people. These were real people.
Yeah. So, your third book is coming out in July. So, what can you tell me about that? So, the Grave Robber Next Door was about Charles and Jesse. And then, what was the other book?
My first book is called Naperville, Chicago's Haunted Neighbor. It has 30 ghost stories. Or, some of the stories are called The Streets of Naperville. And they're just crazy things that have happened in Naperville.
Okay.
So some of the stories fall into that category.
Okay.
And those are some stories that came up during the researching with the Historical Society. Like the time was a plane crashed in downtown Naperville. Back in the early 1900s, a plane crashed, you know. You know, and that's an interesting story, you know. Or the time the mysterious Smith performed at Pfeiffer Hall. He was a huge magician at the time of Houdini and all that. Mysterious Smith and his assistant Olga. And like, so these people were really interesting illusionists back in the early part of the 1900s. And they were at Pfeiffer Hall. You know, stuff like that, or the Love Triangle murders of 1920, stuff like that. The time John Wilkes Booth, I told you, the bones of John Wilkes Booth were on display in Naperville one time. They actually toured with those. Because it's pretty much by most people concluded that John Wilkes Booth was not buried as John Wilkes Booth.
There was
a guy down south, I can't remember his name, it's not coming to me.
Yeah,
who used to claim that he shot Lincoln. He's the guy that did it.
Mm.
And his name's not coming to me. But he did that, and when he committed suicide. And,
was that the guy that drank arsenic?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And they his body mummified, or he was embalmed and his body mummified, and when they did an examination of him, they found that he had a dislocated or damaged ankle from the jump from the box,
mm-hmm.
and there was something else that
he
they
had a scar over
the
his scar.
Yeah.
Just like John Wilkes Booth had. He was
right,
the same
yeah.
size and build. Mm-hmm. I mean, there were like all these similarities.
Yeah, I've read about this like in two different books in the past week. So yeah, it's just still real fresh in my mind. But yeah, that's what cinched it for me was the damaged ankle where Mud had set it improperly.
Mm-hmm.
I think I'm going to have a doggy bag for this because mm-hmm. this is just... I mean, I worked up an appetite walking around in the cold, but I think that's because it's going to have to come home with me. Okay, so what's the third book about? Tell us the title and what's the third book going to be about?
The third book is actually more of a Christian book.
Okay.
And it's called The Afterlife Survival Guide.
Ah.
And The Afterlife Survival Guide is actually based on... a chapter that I had in my book, I think it was the second edition of the book, I had a bonus chapter called How to Not Become a Ghost.
Well, why wouldn't you want to, though?
Mm-hmm. Well,
that's what I'm looking forward to. No. I have a whole list of people I'm going to haunt.
Well, you know, when you research the ghosts, you see that they tend to not be very happy, basically. In fact, I even talk about it on the tour, how they tend to be they use a lot of profanity, they tend to be very angry. The ghosts tend to not be a happy lot of people. Charles and Jesse are unique in that they tend to, you know, be somewhat contented and stuff, but most ghosts are not. They're very... I've been on investigations with a lot of ghosts, you know, or we're getting EVPs, and they drop the F-bomb, and, you know, they're not happy. And so how did they get in this position? And it comes down to that they lived their life a certain way.
Mm.
And they did certain things in their life that kind of leaves them in this spot later.
Mm-hmm.
And some of those problems are... And they're all traced also biblically, you know. Like you look at what they did in their lives that got them where they are, they were warned against it in the scriptures. Christ himself warned against these things.
Mm.
For instance, attachment is a very common reason that goes haunt.
Sure.
They're obsessed, okay?
Uh-huh.
And Jesus says, don't love the world or the things that are in it.
Mm.
Okay? Where your heart is, that's where your treasure is, you know, et cetera, et cetera.
Okay.
And so he's warning of this over and over again, this idea that, you know, you're just passing through here. Don't love this place. You know, don't attach yourself to it. And so that's one of the steps to not become a ghost.
Okay.
Is to not allow yourself to even be passionate about things, even things that you would consider to be good. You know, like for instance, I'll give you an example. Somebody might even desire to be like a great concert pianist. This isn't a good thing.
Hmm.
See, good and evil get blurred in reality because it's all relative.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we say, oh, well, being a concert pianist, that's a great thing. That's a passion. You know, you're going to be a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
I don't think so. When your life can be summarized in a couple of words, oh, he's the greatest violinist of the thing, or he's the best lawyer at the firm. Right? When you get there, you're in a lot of trouble.
Hmm.
You are in a lot of trouble because your spirit is wrapped up in this thing, even something you may consider to be good, and that's not a good thing. Your interests should be varied and spread out. and you have a lot of different interests, and you're not attached to anything except spiritually knowing God and things like this,
mm-hmm.
if you're going to pour yourself into anything, that's what it should be. You can have a lot of interests. You can love all kinds of stuff, but do not, this idea of passion and find your passion, make it happen, all this mm-hmm. is a recipe to become a ghost that's not at all happy when they pass on.
Hmm.
And I know it's
that way.
Yeah, and it's very serious, very serious. And it can be something is, you know, the main thing to remember about it is that it's not about good and bad. You can't say, "Well, I can be passionate about being good."
It's the idea of attachment.
It's the idea of attachment.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, yeah, we Buddhists try to practice non-attachment too.
Yeah. It's very important to not be attached. It's very
important. Yeah, because attachment leads to suffering.
Yeah. I mean, just the idea that you go through life without attachment. You know, I mean, you know, it's things.
May I have a box?
Oh, yes, ma'am.
Okay.
So that's the gist of it. There's several steps, you know, there's different places. Another one would be not forgiving people.
I bet that would be a big one.
Yeah, because like some people, they don't forgive people. So then when they cross over, they don't want to run into those people. They don't want to have these kinds of issues. So they don't want to continue on in their journey. They'd rather stay a ghost than continue on, you know, and have to confront these people or continue on in their judgment because they know that their life was bad. It's important to know that you're forgiven. And that goes even in life itself. You know, a lot of times people are in therapy and everything because they can't forgive themselves. And, you know, or they feel that they should be punished for something that they did and all this. They can't let go of it, you know, this kind of thing.
Yeah.
All right. Those kinds of things wreak havoc in your life.
This is a question that I ask all of my guests on Lights Out, all the investigators. A lot of folks like to say, "Oh, what was the scariest experience you ever had?" But my question to you is, what experience did you have that made you realize that there was something else out there?
But when it comes to like ghosts and stuff like that, I think the thing that really, I've been in investigations where really wacky stuff was happening, like in the room and stuff like that. But I think the thing that I think really made me say, "Holy shit," okay, was when my wife was being yanked out of the bed at the Lizzie Borden house.
That. Oh, please tell that story again.
Tell it again. All right. Well, we were at the Lizzie Borden house in 2007 or so, something like that. Mm-hmm. And it was part of it. We were actually going to Boston for a week. And we said, "Well, let's look into Lizzie's house." So it was available. We stayed in Lizzie's bedroom for like three nights. And the first night we were there, they allowed us to do an investigation, and that's when we got the video of Lizzie in the dining room, you know, where the autopsy was performed and all of that.
Yeah.
And it's a two-minute video of this spirit moving around in the room. And we could see it on the infrared camera on the screen, so we could see it, but we couldn't see it with our eye because the room was just dark.
Okay.
But on the screen, you could see it moving around, I mean, in the room. And like I told you, the guy said, you know, "Looks like we got a ghost," you know. Even he couldn't refute it. He sat back and said, "Holy shit, we got us a ghost." So, but a couple of things happened in the room. My wife, in the middle of the night, thought I was yanking on her arm at first. And I said, "I'm not touching you," but something was pulling her, like, out of the bed, like, yanking on her left arm, you know, pulling on her, you know, trying to get her out of the bed. And when we asked about it in the morning, they said that Lizzie often does that to women, like she's trying to get their wedding ring off or their jewelry off, you know, and some women wake up in the room, their wedding ring will be on the floor.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. Or, you know, or a watch or something like that that they went to sleep in, you know, or whatever. They even said, like, earrings sometimes will be, like, off of the table and on the floor, like, as he was looking at them or something and dropped them on the floor. Nice. But she was a klepto, you know, so they think maybe she's stealing them or something like that. They don't really know, but she didn't take them. She's just, you know, messing with them. So that was one thing. And then my wife was taking a shower, and this was in the morning, and she was in there, and you could hear the shower and everything. And then suddenly there was this loud, like, thud. It sounded almost like if you took a hair dryer and, you know, like one of the blow dryers, and you threw it on the floor. Like, that's the kind of sound it was. And I was like, what the heck? And I hit the door, and I said, are you all right? I don't know what the hell was going on. And she goes, something knocked me out of the tub. And I pushed the door open, and my wife is kind of like wedged between the tub and the toilet. Like, she's like on the floor, like wedged between the two. And I go, what the hell happened? And she's like getting up, and she says, I was in the shower. She says, and something kicked me or hit me right here on my hip. And she said, I moved this way, but hit the edge of the tub, and then flipped that way when I hit the edge of the tub. I'm like, what, this?
Whoa.
She goes, but I felt it, like, either push me or kick me or punch me on the side. She goes, and it, like, hit me against the tub, and then I flipped over that way. So my wife was, like, not real happy about staying at Lizzie's, you know. I told you, like, after Lizzie's, she kind of cooled to the whole ghost hunting thing.
Yeah.
And I would have to go along with her in that Lizzie kind of was a turning point for us. I think that as far as, like, knowing that there's spirit stuff, seeing the video, the 2-minute video with the thing moving around, it was right there. I mean, there's no getting around it. That was there. And then the encounters we had in her room really kind of, you know, drove it home that there's something going on in this house, you know, big time, you know.
Oh, amazing.
But, you know, I've encountered a lot of stuff, you know, over the years, but those are probably the ones that I would put at the top. As far as Naperville is concerned, I would say the phantom in the basement, when the psychic was saying, I see it, you know, and because I've never seen, that girl had seen everything. I mean, she was on investigations all the time, and she was not afraid. I mean, she would do all kinds of stuff, and she looked like she was really scared of that thing. And when I said, what do you see? She, like, pushed me backwards, saying, I can't protect you from it. Get back. You know, like, I mean, she was concerned. And so that was like a big deal. And I bet if somebody talked to her, she would say that was a big deal, because she was clearly unnerved or terrified of that thing. And she was not one to get like that. So that was, but people have seen Phantom claim it changed their lives. I've talked to people who saw that smoky thing. In fact, Diane tells a story about these two girls she knew who they used to go jogging. They grew up together and all this kind of stuff, and then they got married and they had houses right down the block from each other, you know, like this kind of best friends their whole lives kind of thing. And one of the things they did was they would go jogging in the morning together. And they were jogging through that park, and that thing appeared in front of them. And terrified them, you know, like, you know. And the people say you're just kind of frozen, like, oh my god, and there's all this cold air coming off of it, and it's like, but it only stays a couple of 10 seconds, 20 seconds, whatever, and it's gone. But it's like that ominous and everything while it's there. And she says that these two women, the girl that was telling her the story is one of them, and she said, we saw it when we were jogging, it was there. And she said, we haven't talked to each other since it was 5 years ago.
Oh!
We cannot bring ourselves to communicate with each other again for fear that thing is going to come up in the conversation, or it's going to remind me of something. And she called it like the friendship breaker or story or something like that. Where these girls actually haven't spoken in 5 years after encountering that kind of thing.
Wow.
How far out is that?
That is... Oh,
I had a lady one time on the tour who told me that years ago, her daughter's like 25 now, 30 years, or whatever it was, and she said, when we have a house, she said, in the historic area, and she said, we were making cookies. cookies. And my daughter was probably like 10
yeah.
at the time. And she said that smoke thing came through the kitchen. It moved through our kitchen. And she said both of us were just like totally freaked out by it, but it only lasted a couple seconds and then it was gone and we were just was like, you know, what the
that's
hell?
That's freaky.
And she said, my daughter was home. She goes, we never discussed it, ever. We never talked about it. And she said, my daughter was home a few years ago for Christmas. And we were sitting there, we were drinking wine or whatever, and she says, my daughter said to me, remember when I was a kid and we were making cookies? And she goes, I looked at her like, we've never talked about this. And she said, and that black thing came into the kitchen. She goes, did that really happen, or did I dream that, or something like that? And she said, I looked there, I said, no, that happened. That happened to us.
Mm.
And she goes, I have, like, it's like vivid in my mind, but like kind of, you know, gone and like vague. Or she goes, it's just a surreal sort of thing. She goes, and I've always wondered if it actually happened or if I just dreamt it. She goes, no, it happened. So this thing is out there. I mean, and it's in Naperville. Mm-hmm. I had a guy on the tour who told me that he lived in Crest Creek subdivision. And he told me that he has seen it 3 times in his house since being on my tour. And he said, every time we've seen it, it's been near my 13-year-old daughter. Yeah.
Oh, that's crazy.
Mm. Yeah. So, you know, I don't know.
Wow.
I don't know. So the phantom is something that I would say in Naperville that's pretty intense.
Yeah.
But then there's...
So why do you think it appears? Do you think it's trying to get justice do you think it's Patrick trying to draw attention to his plight, or is he just trying to freak people out, or... Or what?
Why does any ghost appear? That's kind of hard to say. But I can give you an interesting story. I had some women on the tour. This is probably 6-7 years ago. And they came up to me at the end of the tour. And they said, all three of us are grown sisters. Okay? We're all sisters. There were three or four of them, whatever. And they said, get this. All three of us in our homes have seen the Phantom. And our parents told us stories of seeing that thing in the house.
Wow.
And some of our relatives in Naperville have seen it as well.
Good heavens, that is a well-traveled spirit.
But here's the far-out part. Their family name is Doyle.
No way!
I tell that in my book, and I said, maybe you guys are related to him. I go, Doyle's a common name, but it's curious that everyone in your family has a connection with it.
Very curious.
And your family name going back is Doyle. And they said that's what we're thinking, too, that we might be related to him.
Wow.
So now why this guy in Crest Creek, you know, or all that, I don't know. That I don't know. There was a guy on the tour one time who told me that he grew up in a house... there was this ramshackle place back in like the 60s, or you know, it'd actually be further back, probably be like the 50s, and in kind of it hidden back in the woods in Naperville off of Royce Road. It would have been like kind of boonies, kind of boonies now even. But he said, I grew up in that house. He's an older guy. He said, I grew up in that house, and my sister had this little bed. He goes, it was just a couple of rooms, you know, it was kind of wide open, a couple of rooms. And there were a couple of beds there for us.
Mm-hmm.
He goes, and my little sister, we would see that black thing in the house. And when it would be there, she would get thrown around on the bed.
Mm-hmm.
He goes, she'd go into convulsions. She'd start bouncing back and forth, bouncing up and down on the bed. And he said, and that black thing was there whenever it would happen. And he said, my parents got so unnerved by it after a few times, we sold it, the house, and we moved. I forgot where he said, like Kentucky or something like that. Was it Tennessee or Kentucky? He said, we moved down to Kentucky. He goes, and it never happened again. She never had that happen again. He goes, it was in that house.
Oh, man.
That was a guy on the tour told me that story. So,
okay.
I had a kid on the tour one time. He was an older, I would say an old guy, but he was probably about 40s, something like that, mid-40s. And he said that he had a sleepover one time when he was a kid. And that black thing moved through the house. And he goes, my friends and I still talk about it. So, I mean, like, people are on the tour. And when I talk about it, they're like, I've seen that. You know, or, and they may even be, like, on the tour and that, because maybe because they encountered the spirit, they kind of have an interest in it, in the stuff now. Like, you know, they're curious, you know, now. So that might be why they're even, you know, interested in the tour itself. And, but people have a lot of encounters. I know, like, when people would join the Heartland Paranormal Club, we'd ask them to, you know, just tell us a little about yourself, you know. And everybody, when the question was, why did you join the club, or why do you want to join the club, almost everybody said the same thing. I'm tired of people rolling their eyes at me when I talk about this stuff that I see or what I've encountered. You know, my grandmother is on the foot of my bed every once in a while. I've seen her, or my dad died and I see him. You know, stuff like this. And they tell people and they roll their eyes or say, I'm going to go nuts. So they want to get into an atmosphere where they can talk about it without people rolling their eyes.
Yeah.
And I always had the same line. Well, we're going to roll our eyes too, but not to your face.
Wow. Okay.
If you're ever in Naperville, or even anywhere in the western Chicago suburbs, I urge you to seek out the Naperville Ghost Tour. Information is at hauntednaperville.com or at 630-205-2664. Also, be sure to check out books by Kevin Frantz, Frantz. Titles include Naperville, Chicago's Haunted Neighbor, an exploration through Naperville's bizarre history and true stories of its unrested dead, and The Grave Robber Next Door, a love story, the truth behind Naperville's most notorious secret. I hope you'll join me for the next episode of Lights Out, because we are going out of state. We'll be spending the night at Edinburgh Manor in Scotch Grove, Iowa. So pack your overnight bag, don't forget your sleeping bag, and we'll go lights out.